Welcome, welcome. Okay, so I'm Gabriel Silvarredonda.
Steve, Ubach.
And we're going to do the Evangelion panel. This panel is meant to be not only us talking about the show, but also a discussion. So if you guys have questions at any point, we're going to ask you to raise your hand. Please don't shout. This is not because we don't, I don't care if you interrupt me, but please don't interrupt each other. So just put up a hand. We'll get to you right after we finish our current sentence, most likely. So we did this panel in February at Tsukino-Con. Any of you go to Tsukino-Con, Victoria? A couple people. All right, cool. So we did the exact same panel, but it was slightly shorter. This one's 2 hours, actually, so it's 30 minutes longer. But we have some extra content as well, so we'll be getting through it. All right.
Great.
Special thanks?
So first, some special thanks. Now, if you noticed in the first slide, I had a tag called Sally07 Sound Only. I'm a moderator for a subreddit called Evangelion, or Evangelion. Any of you here go there by any chance? Hands.
Woo!
Now, yesterday we just reached 10,000 subscribers, so we're really happy. Special thanks to those users. They've been supportive. Actually, one more, Eva Monkey. He created the Eva Geeks wiki page, who helped us really a lot in our presentation. But yeah, another thanks to Anime Revolution for letting us host a 2-hour panel. At first, they didn't give it to us. I mean, it's a big slot, right? But thank you for letting us do it. In previous current conventions, we've been to Tsukino and Annie Revo, and we're planning on going to the U.S. on 2015. Maybe Seattle, maybe Portland, something around there.
People like Evangelion, so.
Full house.
All right.
Last but not least, there's a tiny warning. A few warnings, actually. So first, all material in this presentation refers to the original Neon Genesis Evangelion series and its canonical successors, which are the Director's Cut and the End of Evangelion.
So all material used in the presentation, copyrighted, respective owners. We don't own anything we see here, except for a pen drawing that I drew, and it is beautiful. You'll see it at the end. You will see it at the end. Also, I drew a picture of an Eva, which you'll find halfway through the presentation.
Yeah.
I'll point it out to you. It'll be fairly obvious, though, because I drew it. And again, so we're going to be dealing with religious subjects, both about the show and about actual religion, because Evangelion is based off of lots of different types of religions and lots of different ideologies. So, you know, just be warned that we're going to be talking about this. However, this is not an 18-plus panel, so you don't have to worry about anything that's like 18-plus in terms of other content. Just, you know, if you're religious, we're not trying to offend anyone here.
Your discretion is advised, then spoilers.
I would assume
anyone here hasn't seen Evangelion?
I haven't seen most of it. I dragged you here, though.
But here, I haven't seen 3.3.
Nobody cares about rebuilds.
We don't talk about the rebuilds.
Come on.
We might mention them occasionally. The first one's good.
I actually like rebuilds a lot, but
yeah.
It's just not the same as the original, right?
The piano.
All right.
The piano scene. It's pretty good.
So, first we're going to go through a quick rundown of the show. Now, you're all going to be very bored by this, I assume, because a lot of you have seen the show 100 times. But,
quick refresh.
It is a perfect opportunity for you to ask questions. So if you have questions as we're going through the timeline of the show, please, again, put up your hand. We'll get to you right away, and we'll try and get some discussion in. However, things about symbolism or things like that we'll be talking about after our brief rundown of the series. So that'll be...
So don't ask hard questions right now.
Give us the easy ones first, and then we'll get to the hard ones as we go through the symbolism. All right.
It's your start.
So, brief rundown. So, in the year 2015, our protagonist Shinji Ikari is called to Tokyo 3 to pilot Evangelion Unit 01 and kill the angels. He kills them, but due to an unfortunate turn of events, he kills everyone in the world. And after he's killed everyone in the world, he then strangles his girlfriend. Okay. So, we'll be getting a bit more in-depth as we go, don't worry.
This so-called deconstruction sparked a new genre.
In-depth, psychologically intense anime that still remains to this day, and we see newer examples coming out. Mikiko City Actress, for example. You think I didn't notice you?
Yes.
Madoka Magica, Maoto Penguin Drum, things like that, right? Things that want you to think, and not just your normal fan service with sisters, lollies, and oops, lots of kids.
Or in the case of fan service for girls.
Yeah, I forgot about it. Fan service for girls. So another thing that we wanted to mention is, I don't know who many of you are believers of the Evangelion's complex thing. But there's a lot of things in Evangelion that a lot of people don't notice, such as these simple comparisons between characters doing the same things. Small kids doing, the adults doing the things that the small kids did, or even Misato acting the same way as the first angel, third.
Don't ask me.
It's just, symbolism in Evangelion is really well done. It's just, there's things that are very likely just there and that you wouldn't notice unless you studied Evangelion very, very in depth. And there are things that are plain obvious, but a lot of people have forgotten about religion. Canada, for example, is one of the lesser religious countries right now. So it just these types of reference just fade away with time, right? So we'll be looking into some of them. So our story starts with the first ancestral race. They are godlike beings who, by some unknown force or entity, are threatened into dying. So they decide to spread into seven seeds, so-called seeds, and spread life across the universe.
So they do this, as they spread into seven seeds, one of the main things that Steve wanted me to put as a note here is it's really similar to, imagine, like, Harry Potter and Voldemort's Horcruxes, similar to, like, a lich, in the sense that they spread themselves out thin to survive. Each seed is a part of them, and so each seed contains incredible power. But split, they aren't gods, and we'll be talking about how they can become gods in a tiny section.
So jump a few thousand years later, and we go to the second impact, where
this isn't the slide where we put the video, right?
No.
Okay. Where we'll show you a video actually of this happening, and DNA, human DNA, is dives. Keyword there, the translation's pretty interesting, into Adam, which is the second angel, right? Second angel. I know this stuff, but the numbers are just amazing, right? So Adam is the father of all angels, and Lilith is the father of all humans, right? So once DNA dives into Adam, he becomes a super being, a pretty gigantic, god-like man of light, and just destroys half the world. Misato, we'll talk about her. She survives, only survivor of the Katsuragi expedition. It's pretty sad story. Can you go?
Hmm?
Can you go?
Oh. All right. So at this point, we get to the actual series. 3 days before it starts, however, which we see in a flashback, Rei Ayanami begins to link with her EVA unit. And this didn't go so well. EVA unit goes berserk, punches a wall who Gendo and
Ritsuko
are standing behind. So something clearly went wrong. This gets explained a bit later, but it's also not completely clear. But we'll talk about it, for sure. So Shinji arrives in Tokyo 3 at the start of the series. Some stuff happens. He fights the third angel. Did you put the name? Yeah, Sakyul. Using his EVA unit, which he's given by his dad, who owns the corporation Nerve. And Asuka arrives in Tokyo 3. Now I've skipped like 7 episodes, but we're doing a brief rundown. Then we skip another bunch of episodes, and Toji arrives to as the next pilot for his EVA unit. And he is severely wounded by Shinji, because Shinji's dummy plug in his EVA unit is activated. We'll talk a little bit about the dummy plug later. It's basically like a remote control. Not remote, but like, what's a better word?
It's an artificial intelligence based on a specific soul. And the dummy plug that they use on EVA-01 is based on Rei Yanami. The dummy plug used in the mass production of Evangelions is Kaoru's.
Alright, and finally, the Angel
Zeruel
attacks and is defeated and eaten by EVA Unit 01. This marks the kind of
turning point
in the series where stuff starts to go from the casual, you know, Monster of the Week anime into something completely different. And we continue on. EVA Unit 01 becomes a godlike being because we'll explain a little bit about that later, but he eats the engine of the angel. Shinji spends 30 days inside the unit. The spirit Longinus is thrown into space. This is because they had to fight an angel. What was the angel called? Anyways, it was way up
giant,
in the sky orbiting.
Winged angel.
And the only way to destroy it, only way, it was kind of part of Gendo's plan to throw the spear anyway, but is that they threw the Spear of Longinus, which can pierce the AT fields, the shields that angels have. So they throw the spear into space and to destroy the angel. Rei Ayanami suicides to destroy an angel. She's done. It's not like she's... She dies at that point. But we'll talk a little bit about that later. This is actually Rei 2 that dies. There's more raids. Okay. So Kaoru arrives. I don't like Kaoru. I don't know why you like him.
He's like my,
he's developed
he's
in
one
episode.
And he's like my
and
favorite.
He's everyone's favorite character.
He just changed the entire series in one episode, right? We've been waiting for in 23 episodes, Shinji never hits on anyone, and then Kaoru finally arrives and he's gay. So like finally.
All I'm saying is you can't develop a character in one episode. That's all I'm saying.
I was upset.
Alright. He travels to Terminal... Kaoru travels to Terminal Dogma and in a very epic scene is killed by Shinji.
Yeah, very epic scene. Do you keep going? This is your section.
Did you change? Okay.
This is your section.
Alright. So, Death and Rebirth. You actually wrote this. I don't know why I'm talking about it.
Oh, okay. So if you want me to.
What? I don't know anything about Rest and Rebirth.
Okay.
You told me not to watch it.
He did. Death and Rebirth is the most terrible movie, the most terrible anime movie you could ever watch. There's no reason to watch it. Basically, it was created at the same time as End of Evangelion and consists of Death, a recap of the 1994 series, and with some added scenes that later got switched into the director's cut, which makes this movie useless. And the first half of End of Evangelion, which is also useless because the first half of End of Evangelion is in End of Evangelion. So, no reason to watch it. It's useless.
And it's bad.
Oh, here's the mouse. There it is.
I get it. No, you do it.
You have to click here.
It's not terrible according to Play Magazine. Can you talk about it there?
Alright, and then there's End of Evangelion. This is a completely separate movie from the TV series, but it continues the TV series. It was kind of like, I'm not 100%, it was made after the TV series because of like the fan outcry about episodes 25 and 26. Episodes 25 and 26, which are the finale of the TV series, are poorly animated.
No.
They're not bad. They're not bad. They're poorly animated. There's a difference. So, 25 and 26 are a bit of a... I don't know. It's a black screen through 90% of them. And it just shows some words and text and weird like symbols floating about. They're not actual episodes. They just kind of explain what's going on. But a big major part of this is that episodes 25 and 26 are kind of like what's going inside Shinji's head. End of Evangelion is what's going on outside as well. Keep that in mind while we go on. Did you have a question?
Basically, they took the storyboards like, that looks good enough.
Yeah.
Exactly. All right, they had no budget at this point. They spent all their budget on episode 2 when they made the city rise up out of the ground, which was beautiful, but...
It's funny, because in episode 1, they actually mention, throw away all the budget, we don't care, just kill the angels, right?
I mean, yeah, the first
it's funny,
because
it's exactly the same you did. It's exactly
like...
the same thing you did with the series.
Yeah.
You just spend it all in angels and then they... All
right, so end of Evangelion, some stuff happens. Strategic Self-Defense Force is commanded to attack Nerve. Big fights going on and stuff. Sailing. Sends out the mass protection Evangelions. These are pretty cool. They're like white Evangelion units, but like, I don't know. It's a cool fight anyway. They do stuff. We'll talk about it later. Instrumentality. So instrumentality. We have a slide on this, don't we?
Yeah, we do.
Instrumentality.
This is just a run.
We'll talk about it. This is the quick version. Shinji chooses to separate all the souls of humanity into a sea of souls. I can't explain it in 5 seconds. We'll go back to it. He ends up on a beach and strangles his girlfriend / best friend forever / core. we'll get in depth, don't worry. Alright. AT fields? Yeah, I'll do AT fields. So AT fields, we're choosing to do this now, even though we're just about to start our actual in-depth explanation of the series. But AT fields are basically one of the most fundamental aspects of the series. They hold everything together, every living thing. So humans have AT fields. It's a sort of force field that everything has. Angels have AT fields, but angel AT fields are much, much stronger than human AT fields. Ava units have AT fields as well, but they're not as strong as angels, except in berserk mode. We'll talk about that a little later as well. I compared them kind of like to a strong force. It's sort of, without an AT field, something can't hold its physical form, and its soul is kind of mixed in with other souls. It's what separates souls of beings. Again, we'll probably get in depth as we go on. But the strength of the AT field varies, and the actual full name is Absolute Terror Field. This is seen in the intro to Evangelion, which is it's just a random flash through. If you watch the intro, you'll see it. It just flashes on screen saying Absolute Terror Field.
A good idea of why it's named AT Field is because it separates souls. Now, imagine if you lost the barrier that separated your soul from another soul. What would you feel? They know everything about you instantly, right? There's no separation between your identity and his identity. It's the field that holds our existence together, right? So it's the point where you brink into the brink into terror, right? You're afraid of losing that existence.
All right, so angels and Evas. Angels have the fruit of life, also known as S2 engine, which is short for super solenoid. The angels have this because they are the spawn of Adam, whereas humans and the Evas, well, Eva Unit 01, actually, not the others, are spawns of Lilith. So the difference is very major in that angels are much more powerful with their AT fields, and they also have a lot of other smaller differences, but we'll get into angels and Evas more specifically as we go. The AT fields, any AT field really, can be pierced by the Spear of Longness, which generates an anti-AT field. Anti-AT fields are the force that can break an AT field. It's hard to explain. It's actually not really... Okay, it's not a force.
It's a property.
They described it as a property of matter, which is peculiar. But, yeah, question?
Would it be similar to, like, matter and dark matter?
Potentially, yeah. All we know really about it is that it's a property of matter and that it destroys AT fields almost instantly. It's incredibly powerful. That's why the Spear of Longinus is such a, you know, mythical object, because it has a permanent anti-AT field. So it can be used to destroy angels, things like that.
Okay, so now we're going to go through a quick rundown of the cast. Because apparently some people forget about certain things the characters do.
You can imagine what that word is. We can't say it.
Yeah, you know. So he's the son, the only son of Gendo Rokubungi and Yui Ikari. He is, you know what? He constantly says, "I mustn't run away." He is clearly affected by the hedgehog's dilemma, if any of you remember that situation, in which people don't want to get close to others because they're afraid of harming each other. He constantly won't pilot the robot, and then whale pilot the robot. When he does, everything goes wrong. He's a poor guy. Like, really, just poor guy.
Your next slide button doesn't work. Or it works twice.
No. You skipped.
No. This
is
next.
That was it? Okay. Askalang Lee Soryu. Her name actually changes in rebuilds. This is why we don't like to combine original and rebuilds, because they, up to now, there's no specific... there's no consistent theory that will explain the differences between original and rebuild. There's, like, loop theories, time loop theories, alternate realities, things like that, but one thing that's obvious is that they're not in the same reality. So they might be in the same universe, but they're not in the same time reality. So that's why we keep them separate. So Asuka Langley Soryu, the original Asuka, is a very conflicted person in the inside. Her mom was a test subject for the contact experiments, the same thing that killed Shinji's mother, except Asuka's mother did survive, but lost her memories of her own child, so her mom doesn't recognize her, and that, you can imagine, a lot of us like our mothers, right? She is very aggressive, rather than lovable, even though she's supposed to be the tsundere of the story. She teases Shinji very often, and then Shinji gets more depressed, and you know, Shinji's a very easy person to impress, so it's not good. Often has the same defects that she sees in others. This is a very interesting point. Every time you see Asuka blaming someone for being a doll, Rei, for example, you sometimes see that same attitude in her. Like, she blames others for their mistakes, but she often has those mistakes in her. That's really interesting. She's a very bad girl. And is almost victim to, she's a victim to domestic abuse in the last scene. Rei and Ami, now a lot of people call her the lifeless girl, but she actually has a lot of life in her, right? It's just in her tiny little ways. It's not that she can't feel emotions. In fact, she can feel a lot of emotions. We see her crying in the episode right before she dies, and the episode, and in that same episode, her reincarnation, Rei 3, is actually crying just after being born. So she's not that lifeless. She has feelings, and they're there. It's just difficult to express them. She's one of those wallflowers, as we call them. She is the physical clone of Yui Ikari, Shinji's mother, and now here's a quick fact, I think we talk about it later, I don't know. In the Eva universe, you can clone people, but you cannot clone a soul. A soul is a mythical entity bound by the laws of the universe, by the laws of God. And adding that soul to something is basically sacrilege. It's something impossible by human standards in the Eva universe. So the only thing that does get added to the Yui clone is Lilith's soul, which is the only accessible soul that humans have, since they can't open the door of Guff, which is the birthplace of all souls. She has three reincarnations. All of them are killed at one point or another, I guess. The first one is called by Naoko Akagi. Naoko Akagi, who is Ritsuko's mother. The second one is killed by herself during a suicide bomb attack on the angel. also destroys half of Tokyo 3, which is really why a lot of people flee off, and the ASDF doesn't have any issues attacking Nerve at the end. And Raid 3 doesn't exactly die, but, well, yeah, she does not appear at
it's
the end
complicated.
Of the series. It's complicated. You know, she turns into this, like, mythical giant, we call her the giant naked raid, the GNR. She just becomes God, and then she doesn't exist in the same plane of existence anymore. She is kind of like the Virgin Mary. She just ascends into heaven, just disappears. So we can't trust that. Misato Katsuragi is the daughter of Dr. Katsuragi. Now, interesting thing I found yesterday is he doesn't have a name. He's just called Dr. Katsuragi. I don't know why. The sole survivor of the Katsuragi expedition, we already talked about this, she was saved by her father. I'm kind of surprised she survived because an anti-AT field was created, right? So everything would have just like turned to LCL immediately. So what she was doing in the artifact with her father is kind of a mystery. Some theories go that she might have been like the DNA that dove into Adam, or even the prototype used as, well, the test pilot for the first demos, something like that. It's obvious that these theories have some sort of like not enough evidence, because she would remember and she would be more informed in the future of these situations and how to control them, right? So she would have more knowledge than the pilots did. She's in command of Nerve's technical operations branch, and she is the guardian of Shinji and Asuka. Gendo and Yui are Shinji's parents. They are. Gendo actually changes his last name. And normally, the female loses the maiden name, right? But since Yui was of higher status, she was the daughter of one of Sailor's members, Gendo decides to change his last name instead, as a sign of honor, let's say. They have very overpowered world domination skills. Yui is considered by some theorists as a very big bitch. Sorry. She plans all of this stuff about how his son is gonna be the pilot, and how she has to die with him seeing him. Every little bit that she could have planned, she did. And it was all, everything went according to her plan up until the end. Like, we see her even talking to Shinji in the last minutes of the end of Evangelion. It's just everything went just right like she wanted. And you gotta give it to her. Planning everything throughout a 16-year time span is pretty amazing. All of their operations, Nerve, Gehren, are funded by Sele. So, you know, she's the daughter of an influential Sele person. She's obviously gonna get some fat stacks in there. Next. Ritsuko Kagi is the daughter of Naoko Kagi, the developer of the three Magi systems. She's in command of the technical branch of Nerve, so that oversees Magi, the synchronization tests, the Project E, which is Project Evangelion, creating the Evas. She is Gendo's lover, the same thing as her mother. Once Yui dies, Naoko becomes Gendo's lover, and once she dies, Ritsuko becomes Gendo's lover. Quite a harem she's got there. One quote that I like to mention is that actually the first episode that Kaji appears with Ritsuko, he mentions.
That was me.
Oh, I have the same. That's right. A woman with a mole in the path of their eyes is destined to a life of tears, and we see this actually up towards the end where she's crying a lot. Actually, when she kills the Ray clones, when she tries to kill Gendo, when she's questioned by Gendo, like, her life is full of tears, and it's kind of interesting how they foreshadow such things with a very simple quote. Koso Fuyutsuki, there's not much to say about this guy, actually. I thought he was more interesting, but the only interesting part about him is that it appears that he is Yui's lover. I mean, not lover, but crush. I mean, he has a crush on Yui, Ikari, on Ginny's mother. And it seems that that's the exact reason why he actually joined NERV, because he wanted to see her again, and obviously not die, because he, according to the quotes inside the series, he got blackmailed into either joining Gehern, which was the NERV organization at the time, or being the leader from existence. You know, he knows too much about the second impact. He could go public with all of this information and just make Sayle get trashed, or he could work with them and not die, right? So he's working for the enemy. He is a professor of metaphysical biology, which is something we talk about later on, and that's the study of just souls and their metaphysical properties, such as AT fields and stuff like that.
Next is Steve's favorite character.
Clearly best girl, Kawaii desu yone. Look at them curves. Shoots lasers. I mean, what better girl could you have, right? Now that we've cleared the cast, we're going to go back to the plot summary. And so this is the Rising Action. One thing that's very interesting about the Rising Action is the Winged Angel, the Halo Angel, and the Human Angel. So if you put all three together, you have a human or a person with wings and a halo. Does that remind you of anything?
Can I get a picture of the last frame?
Alright.
Okay.
Go for it.
So does that remind any of you of something?
An actual angel,
exactly. So some fun stuff that happens in the series, right?
Thank you.
Yep. We'll put it back at the end maybe for a second or two. If anyone else wants to take a peek.
So episode 21, is this a slide?
Yeah.
No.
What?
Sorry, because... No, okay, it's not
here. It's on the second. Okay, so we have a video to show you, but I don't remember what slide we should put it on. But, yeah. So episode 21, and we're talking about the last four episodes before the ending. These episodes, we're taking into account the director's cut. So the director's cut actually leaves episodes 1 through 20 alone. It's just the save episodes. But 21 and 24 get scenes added from what is Death, from Death and Rebirth. And episode 21 is a flashback. Yes, it's a flashback to the second impact and its immediate years after it. The creation of Gehern and NERV. Naoko's death. The creation of the Magi, the creation of NERV headquarters, and Kaji's death, which is really sad. Now, just to bust the lies that are out there, if any of you believe that Misato killed Kaji, that's wrong. It has been said by the Gainax staff. So yeah. Episode 22 is Asuka's Mind Rape. We all remember that, you know. That epic hallelujah scene. It's pretty repetitive in director's cut, actually. You could listen, some scenes get added, but like, it's just repetitive. Just no, don't rape me. No, don't do this to me, etc. It's really repetitive. If you pause frame by frame, there's words in German which are sex, death, and what was the other one? And no, nine. So yeah. So just no sex and death, but just these three words repeated as she's screaming, no, don't rape me, things like that. Episode 23 is the death of Reitu, so that Halo Angel right there. She destroys half of Tokyo 3, so, you know, nobody wants to live there anymore. Question?
Did you watch this in English?
No. I would not ever recommend watching the English stuff. Cough, cough, I hate Spike Spencer, cough, cough. It's just, well, for personal preference, I just don't like the voices. But dubs also tend to try to fit as many words as they can to the movement of the mouth, so sometimes you don't get the same translations, you get something completely different. from Mexico. I speak Spanish. I watch most of my movies in English. And when I do watch them dubbed, it's like completely different sometimes. So it's just, it's never good to watch a dub if you're trying to be accurate. It's better to watch the subs, because the subs, you can write whatever you want. I've seen subs where like the whole screen is filled with text just by translator note, right? It's just way better when you're trying to be accurate. Episode 24 is the appearance of our gay lover Kaoru. He rocks the world of the Yame fandom, creating a gay Shinji. Were any of you in the Megumi Ogata Q&A yesterday? Do you remember the question where, what are Shinji's feelings towards Kaoru? And she, the translators didn't interfere, she just said, friend. So, I mean, there's mixed feelings there, but I'm pretty sure he's gay. Next slide. Gabe.
See, I clicked the slides. I don't know how you do it.
Are you sure? Do you skip one, or...?
No, that's it.
Okay. End of TV. EOTV, as they call it. End of Evangelion's EOE. So, EOTV is the famous congratulations scene. Don't clap, don't circle jerk right now. we'll do that at the end. Most animation is dropped completely. We see black screens, reused cell animations. Almost everything is recycled from previous episodes, except for one tiny bit in episode 26, in which it's an alternate universe scene at the end of the Perfect Freedom sequence, in which Ray is coming down the street with a piece of toast running to school. You know, just standard anime, high school. It's just a small scene in which an alternate reality is proposed to Shinji, and he's very happy about it. He's like, you know, the world could be happy if I just think it's happy, right? Congratulations! And that's happening. Yeah. End of Evangelion, on the other hand, is completely different. End of Evangelion goes in-depth on what happened at the end of the television series. So the end of the television series is basically at the start of... where everyone gets turned into LCL at the end of Evangelion. So it doesn't really say much about what happened right before that, though. So, for example, the JSDF attack is not very, very well explained. We do see Misato dead, but it's so obscure that most people don't even notice it. We do see Shinji crying, which is Shinji crying because of Kaoru. Now, again, let me talk about Kaoru for a second. And that guy rocked Shinji's world quite a bit. Shinji went through like the breakup process right immediately through EOE, and I was just like, oh my god. So basically, all of that gets expanded upon with a more clear animation and some kick-ass fights with mass production Avas. That's amazing. Sally sends mass production Evangelions, which are as the title says, mass-produced Evangelions. They're not piloted by humans, but by dummy plugs made out of Kaoru. So they're more likely to follow Sailor's orders than a Ray dummy plug that would follow Gendo's orders in that case. Asuka fights mass-production Evangelions. Now, let me tell you right here, Asuka did die during End of Evangelion. There is absolutely no reason to think not to. In one of we see her hand being split apart as a spear of longness like split goes through her hand, right? So like she could have not died in that scene. So why she appears at the end of Evangelion is obviously because she underwent instrumentality and. She was given another chance to live by this mystical entity called the Giant Naked Ray. So the mass production of Miguel is to do Evo-01 and commence instrumentality. We get my four favorite sequences from the entire series, and unfortunately I can't talk about all of them because they take a long time to explain. The sandbox sequence is probably one of the most famous ones. A sequence in which Shinji is playing, or little Shinji, is playing at a sandbox in the park. Two girls that are similar to Rei and Asuka join him to play, and then a mother comes to pick them up. The mother is Misato, has the face of Masaru. And then they leave Shinji alone, and he just keeps playing in the sandbox. And, you know, it's all symbolism, and it's all very complex and hard to explain, but we're not going to talk about it, unfortunately.
We don't have time.
Instrumentality happens. So that's the tumbling down. You know, the comes to Zerthod, comes with death. Then, what are dreams? Now, that's my favorite sequence, and unfortunately, I can't talk about it. I'm really sad. Maybe I'll show the video at the end if we have time. But it's the moment, I think, Evangelion stopped being just anime, and it just started being art. All animation is dropped, and it turns into a live-action 3-minute sequence, something like that. Playing Bach chorale number something, BWV 147, Jesus Joy of Mass Desiring. Just this tiny little piano sequence and such simple questions that just affect one's perspective of the world. What are dreams, guys? What are dreams? They are our replacement of our reality. And where's our reality? It's at the end of our dreams. Last but not least, you skipped I Need You. I Need You as the trucking scene, but don't worry about it. I Need You. According to legend, Shinji's voice actress was asked to choke Asuka's VA. And then asked her what she felt, resulting in the famous line, Kimochi warui. That's according to legend. Story is varied. The original line, according to what we found from the script, was, idiot, I'd never let someone like you kill me.
Just a random fun fact. And a legend.
First ancestral race. They are gods, by every definition of the word. But the interesting part is that they're not... They are, but they aren't. Or they are, but they're very stupid. I don't... You can't reason with a god because we're humans and we're imperfect. But they were faced with extinction and just decided to spread across the universe. What's the next slide?
The plan. Okay, don't go there.
So, even gods can die. That's a very important thing in Evangelion. Apparently, being god doesn't mean you're all powerful, even though it's supposed to. I mean, you can spread your life, but you can't save your own extinction. It's a little bit awkward. Let's say it's a plot hole for the sake of creating the story. They are extraterrestrial creatures. They're not bound to any planet we know of from our solar system. They send their seeds throughout the universe, 7 seeds throughout the universe to spread life. We only know of 2, Adam and Lilith. But if I quite remember, there's a PSP or PlayStation 2 game in which a 3rd seed makes contact with Kaoru. Now, this is like 3rd or 4th tier canon, so it's not really taken into our presentation because of its lack of canonical relation to the original series. But, you know, they do exist according to this, and there's 4 more, 5 more, 5, 5, 5, 7, doing that. 5 more seeds out there with either life or knowledge, so we could have planets full of angels or planets full of humans too. It's really interesting. Their plan was to spread their own life, unite into 1 and divide into 7. So all of their souls, all of their existence, all of their power is divided into 7, which are either life or knowledge. Now, 7 is a very magical number here, and it's really awkward because you can't divide it by 2. So
you can't divide 9 by 2.
No, but see, there's only 2 types of seeds.
Oh, okay.
Up to our knowledge, there's only life and,
yeah,
and wisdom, right?
So there must be 1 extra seed of life or 1 extra seed of knowledge. That's not clear, however, at least not in these TV series or End of Evangelion.
Oh.
Or even the rebuilds, for that matter. But.
Yeah. Next slide.
So, number 7, speaking of the number 7s, there's a few important things you get when a seed lands on your planet.
Oh yeah, the Sim 7 level. you get a game CD, a seed of either life or knowledge, a readme.txt, readmes. Everyone, nobody reads the readmes, except Salia, apparently. And the readme comes as the secret Dead Sea Scrolls, specifically. Now, the secret the Dead Sea Scrolls, has anyone heard of them in real life? Okay, so they are a set of texts, biblical texts, specifically, from the Old Testament. And I don't recall if they have New Testament in there, too, but around that. You know, it's Judeo-Christian or Judeo. But they are very, the quantity is very large. They're just a bunch of texts. Now, according to the NGE universe, there's a secret set of texts that got separated from the text that got released to the public, which we all know. This secret set of Dead Sea Scrolls is what what Salie and what Nerv refers to as the Dead Sea Scrolls. It's a set of instructions or a guide that says when the angels will come, how the angels will be. It's just a set of instructions, precautions, instructions on the Spear of Longinus, which is the uninstaller. The Spear of Longinus, as we mentioned, can break any AT field, so it basically comes as the uninstall. If you ever want to clear that hard drive of this shitty game that is life, you just spear it.
But just a reminder, anytime anyone has questions, toss your hand up.
The accident. The first step back. Adam, the white moon, arrives first. You know, he's just chilling here, ready to like create angels and be happy, and Lilith just crashes the party, and her spear breaks, and everyone's in chaos, and it's like, oh, you're not supposed to be here, what are you doing here? And Adam's like, chill, I'll just go to sleep, right? So that's what happens. Adam's Lance of Longinus activates, and he is not sealed for all eternity. Lilith can run free and populate the earth like a fuck bunny, I don't know. Next slide. The Katsuragi expedition and the second impact. Humans die, as we already... Wait, this is the slide. Does this slide say... Dump 21?
Yes.
Okay, we're gonna dump 21 first.
So this is the director's cut, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so in the director's cut, you see about a minute 30 scene from the second impact. This is the only information that's actually shown at all of the second impact in basically the entire TV series and in Evangelion. So it is incredibly important because it's all we know about it. However, there's a lot of theories about what it could mean. We have our own, and we'll talk about it in about a minute and 30 seconds.
You can see both Keel Lawrence from Salie and the scientist cast are both talking at the same time, so the subtitles might be a little bit confusing.
That's all we know. So the second impact was caused by humans in an experiment. This is what you saw there. We made our own theory about kind of what we think happened in the second impact. We believe, since they're speaking about the Lance of Longinus and all this stuff, that they tried to inject the DNA of Lilith in some way, so either humans, which have somewhat the DNA of Lilith, or perhaps perhaps Lilith herself, who knows. But they tried to inject Lilith DNA into Adam using the Lance of Longinus. Perhaps they thought that using the Lance, because the Lance is supposed to, you know, keep things from, keep the anything from expanding. It's an anti-AT field, supposed to keep things, you know, in control, right? So we believe they may have used the Lance of Longinus as a sort of syringe to infuse the DNA of Lilith in some way into Adam. Unfortunately, clearly it doesn't work because all of Antarctica is destroyed and over 2 billion are dead. A giant anti-AT field is created at that zone as well. The only survivor, again, this is the Katsuragi expedition, the only survivor is Masato.
So,
continuing with the second impact, right after this recording happens, 2 billion people, which at the time would have been one third of the world, not half the world, as the series says, died.
You say that, but the population was lower back then.
No, no, that's using the population.
Oh, really?
Time.
Yeah,
yeah, I recalculated with real world.
Oh, wow.
I recalculated with our population from 2000 rather than their actual number. From you know, it was made in 1994. The second impact happened in 2000, so they didn't actually know how much it was going to be, right? So
okay.
I just recalculated using our actual population growth, which apparently was pretty high because it was lower than what they actually estimated. They estimated about, I think, two-thirds or one-half of the world dead, something like that. Anyways, over half the world dies. I mean, over one-third of the world dies. And it's pretty devastating. It basically creates a Red Sea in Antarctica, and it's just awful. A lot of marine life dies, a lot of land life dies. They lose the capacity to have seasons. It's just a major ecosystem disaster throughout the world. So what about the third impact? The third impact is throughout the series, it's considered a theoretical situation in which Adam and Lilith fuse to create an even bigger anti-AT field that would devastate the entirety of the planet. Now I say theoretical in quotes because, I mean, they're not expecting it to happen. They're working to prevent it. But it does, you know.
What exactly do you mean by impact event? Because, like you say, okay, well, there's an anti-AT field that's generated around Antarctica, but Antarctica barely covers a couple percentage of the global population.
Yeah, that's an interesting thing that happened.
How does second impact being localized around Antarctica mean 2 billion people dead?
So it wasn't so much that 2 billion people died instantly, I believe. I believe they mean more of 2 billion people died as a result of the second impact. It was stated later by to the general public, it was said that it was
a meteor
that hit Antarctica. Well, if a meteor actually hit Antarctica, it probably would have actually had a similar effect to the second impact, in where it's not just like people were hit by a meteor, but also there's no more seasons.
The waves would have hit coasts, Japan would have been devastated by tsunamis, things like that. Just it's not only about the actual AT field that could have really, I mean, people from South America, South Africa, people like in the south regions of the globe would have been affected by the AT field maybe, but the actual shock wave was probably the more devastating part.
Instrumentality. So as you can see, instrumentality happens when Shinji decides kind of to merge all the souls together into one giant mass of orange tang. And this giant mass contains every living soul on the planet. And they're all, you know, floating around and without their own identity, really. However, as instrumentality happens, it is possible for people to regain their own identity if they can find their own heart. This is kind of like a philosophical view of it. But literally it means that people can actually regain their own identity. It's difficult. However, everyone is kind of merged together during instrumentality, so, you know, some weird stuff happens, but
after instrumentality, we hear the quote from Yui. Everyone is able to return to their own bodies or to their own existence as long as they can imagine themselves within their own heart. I don't know why guy that did something. Freaked out. If you're able to imagine your own existence again, and you're able to imagine yourself living a happy life, but that's the whole point of instrumentality, right? So being able to regain that existence of yours and to live, to have the will to live. It's kind of like Saw. You remember Saw, right? Here's a more cruel version of this. It's just they're looking for people who have the will to live, right? That's instrumentality.
Is that the picture you drew?
No.
That's a random one effect.
We do search the webs for funny pictures of this and stuff like that. Except most of mine are...
most of his are 18 plus, so unfortunately we can't really show them. Or if you are 18 and you have ID, you can come up after and we might show you a few. So we get into the symbols section.
So this is actually my section. I specialize in symbolism and theological analysis of Evangelion. He symbolizes in the more scientific part. His section comes after. So Dead Sea Scrolls, Thorfgaf, LCL, Sphere of Longinus 7, Adam, Lilith, and Eve, Evangelion, the title, the first ancestral race, I don't know why that's not capitalized, which is God, and the Seed Chambers. Next slide.
So, Dead Sea Scrolls.
Dead Sea Scrolls. Now, this is the only picture that exists in the series, not even in the series, in the opening of the Dead Sea Scrolls. I actually went around searching for if it actually had any meaning, if it had a real-world equivalent, if we could read it at all. Turns out we can't. It's just fictional. So that was a sad discovery. But I did go around Reddit. I did go around several different sources. I even thought it was Chinese lists of sorts. It was nothing, unfortunately. As I already mentioned, these documents already existed in reality. They're called the secret Dead Sea Scrolls inside the series, because they're a secret part of the actual Dead Sea Scrolls. And they contain information on the origin of Lilith, the angels, the Lilin, Adam, the first ancestral race, their extinction event, everything that dates back from before humans existed. The Dwarfguff is a more complicated symbol. If you didn't know about it, it's the birthplace of all souls in Orthodox and Jewish tradition. And it's not only the birthplace, but according to Gabe, the death portal. At least that's how he named it. It's the gate through heaven. Also, you might say, it's not only where you begin your existence, but where you end it, and it's open during the second and third impact. Hence, why the third impact is just a bunch of little red dots flying around everywhere. I think there was a picture we had before of the third impact, in which you can see the souls flying around. The thing about the Dwarfguff is that after instrumentality, it remains open. So it gives access to people to exist again. And that's the whole point that we just talked about in instrumentality. It's if you have the will to live, you can. If not, you can still be part of the one of us. of the singular godlike being that is Ray.
Right.
Next slide.
LCL.
LCL is, there's actually a pretty fun theory, which I mentioned right there. LCL might be phonetic for El Cielo, which means heaven, literally, in Spanish. Well, sky, but that's how they refer to heaven, too. So, this could explain why your lack of a soul and existence, just the unification of all souls, is heaven in itself. Because you're part of God, you're part of the giant naked ray. A fun fact about LCL, actually, is it contains all nutrients for life to exist. It is the primordial soup that creates all life, and that all life comes to an end with. The CFLCL is pretty much heaven, as I already mentioned, but also, yeah, just the graveyard of all bodies. The Sphere of Longinus is more biblical from the New Testament. It's the sphere in which they poked Jesus to see if he was dead. they didn't have a stick around, I'm guessing they used the spear. Or he was just high up at the cross. It has the ability to penetrate AT fields. Okay, so spear or lance of longinus. Now, this is a greatly debated thing. Longinus noyari is the actual translation, I mean, the actual words in Japanese, and it refers to a spear. But a spear is a type of lance. So you can refer to it as lance of longinus, but it's more cosmetic than anything, just to say double L's. Really, you can say either one. Spear would be the most accurate because it's a specific weapon rather than a lance, which is a broader section of weapons. Often referred in the anime board of 4chan as the lance of longitude. As we already mentioned, the seeds of life are divided. I mean, there are seven seeds of life that spread throughout the universe. One cool reference is, on the seventh day, the wall of Jericho fell. Now, Asuka uses the reference of the wall of Jericho, and that's a pretty interesting section of the story in which she's like, you know, it's the day before both of you dance like you want to win section. And it's where they both fight together, dancing, playing extreme DDR with like 16 pads. Like, what the heck was that? I don't know. So they practice, and the last night, Misato's not there, and she decides, you know what, I don't want to sleep in the same room as you, I'm going to sleep in the closet. And she says, this is the wall of Jericho, and it shall not fall. And I'm pretty sure she got the reference wrong, because that's not how it works. The wall of Jericho did fall, according to Jewish tradition.
And they danced around it.
They danced around it, they played their trumpets in the morning, and God just made it fall. And the same thing happened with Asuka. Involuntarily, she went back to Shinji, and just left right beside him, and Shinji was almost about to kiss her, and she's like, Mom, and he's like, hey,
it's a little
no.
Creepy.
Next slide, good.
I clicked, bro.
I made this graph. I'm pretty proud. It's pretty hard to understand, so I'm going to around and explain it. So, in Christian Genesis, or the general New Testament Genesis, we have God creates Adam, and from Adam's rib, he creates Eve. So that's why we have God and Adam, the same tree. And from Adam and Eve, there lies humanity.
Yes.
Actually, there is a reference, because in the original Genesis story, it could just be like a editing error, that God creates man and woman twice. And the theory is the first woman was Lilith. And there's like a book of Lilith that God lost.
Yeah, we're going to talk about it in a second. Kind of the same thing. Jewish Orthodox Genesis, God creates Adam and Lilith as equal beings. He does create Eve from Adam's rib, but that comes later, right? Lilith was a pretty bad woman, according to this. There are several explanations as to why. I don't remember the exact one. Some say it's because she didn't want to kneel and
she would
do stuff. And she's turned into a demon, and she actually goes and hunts children at night and eats them. A lot of old Jewish plates, there's a very interesting tradition in which in Jerusalem, you find it specifically. The priests, the rabbis, that they call them in Jewish, they would make plates to keep Lilith out and put them upside down in a corner of the house. And that would act like a dream catcher, like they call it. For specifically Lilith, so it would keep Lilith away. I've also heard in another documentary from a history channel, but I wouldn't trust it. It's a pretty cool explanation, though, if you want to believe it. Lilith might have turned into Lilith Abbey, or Lullaby, and that's why we sing lullabies to keep the demon away from the children. This specific demon, Lilith. Continuing, Adam gets his rib taken out, and Eve gets created because God is like, here, I'll make you a better woman. That does what you say. And humanity is created. It's the same story as before, with a small addition. Now we go to the NGE creation lore, which is far more complex. The far witches are equivalent of the god creates Adam and Lilith, just as in the Jewish Orthodox. But Lilith spawns directly to humanity. The humans spawn directly from Lilith, and angels spawn directly from Adam. Now, humanity, using Adam and the angels, creates Ava 00 and 02, 03, 04, 05, etc., etc. 01 is created by using human knowledge and the spawn of Lilith. So basically, we got a slightly modified family tree here with far more complex incest routes.
This next slide.
Evangelion. Evangelion is often translated, let's start from the start. The actual title for Evangelion is Shinseki Evangelion, which means roughly the actual translation in English, Neon Genesis Evangelion. Which, if we again put another layer of translation, it means Gospel of a New Era. Now, Gospel is not the word I would use because it's incomplete. Now, in most Latinized languages, cough, cough, not English, cough, cough, you're bad, slight modified portion of Evangelion, or Evangelium, to refer to the Gospels. That's the word for Gospel. In English, you made Gospel for some reason, even though the word's right there, right? It's kind of useless. So Gospel would be an incomplete translation. Evangelion comes from the Greek Evangelium. If anyone can read Greek, I cannot. I slightly did this. So it divides into Ev and Angelos, right there. And Ev means it's a prefix for good, or something, the best of something. And Angelos, which later created the word angel, is messenger or message. So, a good news or message. So, Neon Genesis Evangelion turns out to be, more accurately, a good message for a new era. So, or something along those lines. So, we see in the end, the end of Evangelion is pretty sad when you think about it, but it's also pretty happy. The end of Evangelion, if you remove I Need You, is supposed to be like this happy same equivalent of the congratulations scene. That's another fuck you there that we'll talk about in a second. There we go. So God, the Far, they represent God itself, as I've already talked about. And it spreads its own life over the universe to populate it. It hoped for humility and happiness rather than perfection, hence why it didn't divide itself in equal parts of life and knowledge. It just wanted everyone to live their own separate lives, right? It wanted not for other gods to be raised and created, but it wanted a more simpler life form, humans, angels, to exist and just to live their simple lives and to not fight with each other, etc., etc. You know, the standard religious stuff of let's be peaceful and happy. So, hence why they divided themselves into either life or knowledge, so that, and why they added security systems such as the Lance of Longinus, so that people like us wouldn't go around and poke Adam, and it did happen either way, which is unfortunate. But we shouldn't have been poking around with Adam, and we shouldn't have done this thing, and we would have all lived happily ever after without having to turn into LCL and then find our own will to live in order to live again. Damage indeed.
Before we get into my section, we have a question for you guys, and let's see if anyone has a good.
At Tsukino-Con,
yeah,
it was quite an interesting question.
So we put it up here.
If you could meet Hideaki Anno, the director for Evangelion, what would you ask him?
And pro tip here: don't ask him what does Rey like, because he will answer with.
That's a good question. I don't know.
So.
Quote.
Direct quote. Yeah.
How many drugs did you take?
More than drugs. More than drugs. He was actually suffering from depression at the time. I think that was more likely the cause of it, but who knows?
the scene, several scenes in which, for example, when Asuka gets mind-raped or when Shinji is sharing his time inside an angel's alternate dimension. What was the alternate dimension called?
The angel?
The sea of something. Yeah, the sea of Derek. Or Dirac, I don't even know how it's pronounced. All of those scenes in which he's in the train or in which he's talking to himself, stuff like that, there are theories in which they say he was slightly drugged on LCD, on LSD, not LCD, and or other stuff.
The LCD, oh.
The LCD, man, those screens. and stuff like that, because they're really, according to these people, it's what you feel like when you're on these drugs. You feel like you're out of this world. Just, you could even like say talking to yourself, or Shinji talks to Rei or Asuka most of the time, even though it's not the actual person. So yeah, another one.
You had one there. Okay, we're gonna talk about that at the end.
Do we have a slide for it at the end?
I don't think we have a slide for it, but it's our own theory. It's not clear. I mean, honestly, there's no theory that absolutely says 100%, like, why did Shinji strangle Asuka at the end? But we have our own theory, which
we
think
right
is fairly accurate.
You could dump it right now.
Do you want to dump it right now?
Right now.
But there's so much more stuff. Okay, we'll dump it now. All right, so our own theory, which we came up with after watching that scene, five times in a row?
A few times.
Okay, more like two, I'm exaggerating. But anyways, we came up with a theory that, how did it start? We started with saying that the difference between angels and Evas, or, you know, like angels and humanity, was that angels do not actually possess a true soul, in that they don't possess free will. This is the biggest difference. This is how the theory started, is that the angels do not possess free will, while the things with the seed of knowledge do, because of the seed of knowledge. That's what it gives you. So we ended up going about this and being like, okay, well, at the end, the very end, Shinji has been walking around this beach for a few days, and because he returned to his body, he decided that he wanted to return to his body because he wasn't happy in the LCLC. He wasn't happy coexisting with everyone else. This, for him, was actually like him saying to himself, no, I can't do this. If you look at episodes 25 and 26, the ending is the congratulations scene, which is like, yay, Shinji, you can be your own self now. Like, you can be happy, right? He understands that he himself can be happy. That's why people are congratulating him. And then there's End of Evangelion. At the very end, Shinji decides that he can't. This is all our theory. He decides that he can't. So he finds his own body again. He walks around this beach for a few days and eventually finds Asuka's body. And at this point, he lays down with her for a little bit. Some stuff happens. You find it?
Let's just look at the scene specifically to just get a fresh reminder. That's his mother. sense sometimes.
So we're about to get to this actual strangling scene. But our theory...
We're
going to
pause it here, right before the ending. So as we continue, you know, we saw... Apparently it didn't pause. Okay, so we're just going to go over it.
Whatever.
We saw Shinji repeat, I would just be restating the obvious over and over. I am me. He's come to the decision that he is. The same decision he made in episode 25 and 26. He is happy. He is ready to return to the real world. He's hyped for the new game engine of Evangelion. He's ready to live his life. And then he awakes on a beach alone, wanders a few days, puts a Masato's cross in a tombstone of sorts, and just keeps going. Starts hallucinating. Finds Asuka's body, you know. It's been there, sitting there, unconscious, probably. You see she's there, but she doesn't react at all. So he starts... Just imagine being alone for a few days. You've just taken the decision that your life is going to be better, and it's totally going the most horrible way you could think of. So you start going crazy. You start... questioning your own decision. You start having that human weakness that we all have, in which we regret that decision that we took sometimes. And he just demonstrates it by strangling Asuka. By just saying, you know what? Just let me die here. I took the wrong decision. Just save yourself. Go back to the LCLC. And she wakes up from just right before that. And she says... our most famous line ever.
And that's it.
And so we get this how disgusting. Asuka realizes you're regretting that decision, aren't you? You're disgusting. You can't even stand by your own decision. And that's what we think of the end of Evangelion. The end of the end of Evangelion means, you know, if you take a decision, just go through with it. Just feel proud of it. Don't regret it, unless it's wrong. But learn from those mistakes and.
So Shinji made the decision to be happy,
yeah,
and then he took it back.
And that's why.
And that's what we think, basically. What that ending was supposed to encompass. But again, it's all theory, and we don't know. So, all right, moving on.
Tap back into the
question. Yeah, where is this? Here?
Yeah, that one, and then.
All right, so we're going to talk a little bit about more of the science aspects of Evangelion. Angels are, again, the spawn of Adam, and Evangelion units are also kind of the spawn of Adam, except for Eva Unit 01, which was more of a Lilith thing. All right, so the Eva units, do I have an actual slide on this? I think it's just a picture.
Body.
Yeah. So the Eva units, they're about 80 feet tall. They're big. They look mechanical. They're actually not. But Steve and I have a little bit of a discussion on whether they're cyborgs. which I think they are, but it's something that not everyone might agree with me. So the EVA units are controlled, kind of, by the metal plating they have. This metal plating not only keeps them, you know, somewhat safe, I mean, it's metal armor, why not, but it also is used for control. So, but inside is the actual biological creature that is the angel. And they are manufactured by the humans, but a lot of them from more of a soul of Adam. So they don't actually have their own soul. So instead, they have to have the soul of something else. They have to have a soul put into them. Now, it's said in the show that the soul must be the soul of the pilot's mother for proper syncing. So in the case of, for example, EVA Unit 01, it's Shinji's mother. In the case of EVA Unit 02, it's Asuka's mother, etc. Now, EVA Unit 00, which is Rei's unit, is a little bit trickier, because Rei does not actually have a mother. Rei is a clone. She's just a clone. She doesn't actually have a soul. The soul is put into her. Which means that, in this way, it's a little bit tricky to say that it's always the pilot's mother, because Rei 1, which is the first clone of Rei, is not the mother of Rei 2. That's not how it works. It's slightly different. So, but for everything else, it's the pilot's mother. The pilot has to synchronize with the soul inside the Eva. The syncing is referred to a lot throughout the entire series. Syncing is usually anywhere from, like, I think the lowest was like Asuka's 10% at one point when she was in her kind of bad state, bad mental state. But it goes all the way up to 100%, and you see 400%, 400? 300? 400, I don't remember, a big number. When Shinji is in EVA Unit 01, going to godhood, right? When he's actually eaten the soul of the S2 engine of an angel, and ascending to godhood in this way. Next.
That's one of his drawings.
There you go. It's beautiful. All right, so this is more of an explanation thing. That's why I drew it. The core itself is basically like a portal to another dimension. And it is a little weird that way. What happens is this is the plug. This is the plug where the pilot sits. You can see the little green there. That's where the pilot is. The plug is inserted through the back of the EVA and towards the core of the EVA. This is not the scale, by the way. I'm not very good at drawing, as you can see. So when the plug enters the core at any small amount, that is the sync ratio as well. The higher the sync ratio, the deeper the plug into the core. When you're at 400% sync ratio, you are actually in another plane of existence. The entire plug, the entire pilot at least, it's not, Steve, I don't know, we're a little confused about how big the plug is compared to the core, but.
Okay, so in Evangelion, there's no, for example, there's no definite size to how big an Evangelion can be. Some sort, like if you look at the scale in some episodes, they're quite small, and if you look at scale in other episodes, they're like really big, like buildings big. And officially there's a dictated size of 80 feet, but like that sounds really small, right? Sometimes they're really big, and sometimes they're really small, and so the core can also vary in the drawings. It can be from some angles it can look really big, and from some angles it can look like a really small ball. The theory about synchronization comes from the fact that they say there's several instances, both in Rebuilds and the original, in which they say when the plug depth is too high. They mention the plug depth when it's too high, when it's really into the core, the synchronization ratio is also really high. So if there's a correlation between both of those, we can theorize that the plug depth also means the symbolic integration towards the mother's soul. So how you relate to your mother and how fond of her, let's say, how your feelings are towards this person, create a sort of synchronization between yourself and the Evangelion. So when you reach 400%, for example, you can't really just keep going deeper. You can't just go through the core, right? That doesn't work that way. So the most obvious answer would be back into the Sea of Derek when Shinyu was made into LCL, just disappeared from the core. When the synchronization ratio is too high, you just cease to exist in our plane of existence and just go into the core's plane. So that's why once Shinji finds his own way out, or his mother kicks him out, something like that. You know, it's one of those weird episodes in which everything is really weird. Shinji comes out like completely naked because he couldn't stay bound to his physical plug suit. Actually, there's a spoof in that scene that he wasn't wearing the plug suit the episode right before he turned into LCL. So the clothes that should have appeared were his normal high schooler clothes. But basically, the higher the plug depth, the higher your synchro ratio is, and the more you cease to exist in our plane of existence. And it's hard to get back, obviously.
And again, the sync ratio directly relates to how well the pilot can control the EVA unit. So as you have a higher sync ratio, you can command the EVA unit to do basically whatever you want. Now, this is why I personally say somewhat that EVA units are cyborgs, because while they are biological, don't get me wrong on that, they are generally only able to be moved or controlled when they are controlled by the pilot, which requires the plug. So if it requires a mechanical piece, that's why I somewhat say that it's a cyborg. Yeah?
Wouldn't that just be the case that the unit 01 is made from Lilith, which has free will, whereas Adam does not have free will? So
yes, but I'm speaking about the EVA units in general.
Yeah.
So EVA unit 01 is actually capable of moving on its own, even without a plug inserted. We saw this in episode 1, where the EVA unit actually protects Shinji without any command from anything. Yeah?
I think there's some evidence backing that up when in the episode, I forget which one it is, but Shinji's being attacked and they start severing the nerve connections between him and the EVA. I think it was actually the first one, so there's obviously some sort of
yeah.
human intervention happening in between that
mm-hmm.
system.
Yes.
Yes, so definitely the metal components of the EVA are controlled by the pilot while the pilot is inside. But there's the exception, which is
berserk
mode. So berserk mode is the mommy mode. This is the mode where the Evangelion unit takes over for the pilot, because the pilot clearly isn't there doing their job properly and gets themselves killed all the time. So the EVA unit's like, no, okay, I'll deal with this one. In this sense, the mother soul actually takes control of the EVA unit. It can regenerate limbs. Its combat abilities are incredibly enhanced. Its AT field becomes almost the same power level as that of Angel's. Almost. EVA units still can't fly. Angels can fly with their AT fields. But almost the same level. They can erode AT fields. You saw in the first episode the EVA unit 01 erodes the AT field of an Angel and then destroys it. And it's generally way more powerful, but you can't actually control it. So it's a little bit scary sometimes. Alright, so angels are different in many ways and similar in many ways. However, like I said before, angels have the fruit of life, which means, and here again is somewhat theory, that they do not possess free will. They are more of primal creatures. They can, however, choose their own shape because they have the fruit of life. They can really become anything they want to. If you see a trans-dimensional angel who's just a shadow, appears as a shadow over the city and starts sucking things in. You see the microscopic angel that can hack into the Magi computer system. And you see giant flying halos and Rami-chan. That's Steve's favorite character. So they're much more powerful, for sure. but they, because they don't have free will, because they don't have a true soul, they lack, because they lack the fruit of knowledge. In this way, they're also less powerful. But, I mean, they're just different in that way.
Any question over there?
Yes.
Yeah.
So if they don't possess free will, is there any speculation as to where their urge to do these things comes from?
So again, it's primal instinct. The urge for angels is that not so much that they want to do something. Usually they want to do something in particular, though. For example, the microscopic angel, its goal was to hack into the Magi system. Now, that may seem strange. Like, why would some primal beast want to hack into the Magi system? Well, the angel decided that would be the easiest way to gain access to what we believe Lilith or Adam. Generally, it's mostly accepted that the angel's goal is to somehow gain access to either Lilith or Adam. In the case of Kaoru, when you see him go down to Terminal Dogma and the Geofront, like all the way down, he gets there and he sees that the body that's down there is not the body of Adam, but it's actually the body of Lilith. So he realizes this and is like, oh, okay, well, I'm kind of a spawn of Adam, so Shinji, you either kill me or I'm going to still kind of, you know, merge with this thing and kill all of you. So Shinji has to kill him, obviously.
So just to add there, so it doesn't matter who they look for, as long as they find either Adam or Lilith, it's a pretty catastrophic event that's gonna occur. So it just
So Kaoru is an angel, right?
Yes.
Then why does he have that kind of free will to determine like not to go into that?
Because
also the ability to kind of empathize.
Because he's an angel, but he's not born. He's born from a human. He has a human body, and he has a Lilith soul inside him. Except, it's taken over by Adam's soul. So in the second impact, he's born on the day of the second impact. Actually, his birthday was quite a bit ago. We celebrated it with cake and stuff. When Kaoru was born, it was the second impact. It was Adam's life. Adam's soul just got thrown away into, I don't know, just somewhere in the planet where Kaoru was born and got into some body. Sayle thereafter began searching for him because they knew this would happen. It's all in the Dead Sea Scrolls, right? And once they find him, they subdue him and take him into Sayle headquarters and raise him as their own child for evil plans, right? So basically, Kaoru just wants to look for his body, his Adam's body, or he can still find Lilith and destroy the world either way. So it's just a matter.
So Kaoru's a little bit different, right? Like he's an angel, but he's also human. Not human in the sense that like he is human and he's also Adam, but he's not Adam in the sense that like if the Adam soul were to go into him, which it did, that the whole world would explode. It's not quite the same. But yeah, Kaoru is different from the other angels in that he is human. So that's the best answer I can give without going way too in-depth into random shenanigans. All
right. I believe you now. It takes a long time.
Yeah, see? This takes time. All right, so the core of an angel is the S2 engine. The S2 engine, super solenoid, is the fruit of life, basically. It's what gives them power, limitless power, nearly. This makes them completely different from the Evangelion units in that the Evangelion units need a power source. They have an umbilical cord that leads into what we assume to be some giant generators going underground. But the umbilical cord is needed for an Evangelion unit to function, otherwise it only has battery enough for 5 minutes. Except in Berserk mode, because in Berserk mode, the EVA unit is actually just powered by the mother.
The mother's will to live.
The mother's will to live. It's a little weird, but yeah, okay. So within the core is their primitive soul. Primitive, like I mentioned sometimes that, like, you know, angels don't really have a soul. I mean, they do, but it's incredibly primitive. That's why they don't have free will. It's a primal instinct more than a soul. So in this way, it's they have limitless power. They can choose their own form. They can fly. They can do all these crazy things, But they're born of Adam. They're born of life, not knowledge. They're not smart, particularly.
I'd just like to add to this primitive soul thing, again with the AT fields, or a question.
Just comment on it. So basically a soul is the difference between a sentient and non-sentient being?
No, because as I was just about to say, angels have bigger souls. You might think, why? Well, let's think about it. How many humans are there on Earth? 7 billion. Now divide Lilith's one soul for 7 billion. Now divide Adam's one soul between like 20 angels.
80.
It's just, they have, the difference between our AT fields that just separate our existences and their AT fields that let them fly is the fact that they have more a bigger soul. So soul doesn't dictate the sentience, but it does dictate the power of your
AT field.
AT field.
Yeah. Yeah, so the size of the soul dictates the power of the AT field, but that does not give them free will. That is completely different. So because they're spawns of Adam, they have a different type of soul than these things born of Lilith. Things born of Lilith have a soul that allows them free will and thought, like true sentience, true understanding.
That's why we can build the Evangelion units based on Adam, for example.
Exactly, because if you build an Evangelion unit based on Adam, it doesn't really have its own free will. So you can put a soul of a human mother, into the Evangelion unit and then pilot it. It's very convenient.
Okay.
All right.
This is basically the end of our presentation. So now you can start the congratulations circle here.
But we still have some time, right?
Yeah, we still have 24 minutes, so we have
awesome.
We have Q&A and we have the pen
theory.
Oh,
do you want to show the pen theory? I will do my pen theory. You'll all love it. Pen is my favorite character of the series.
This is non-canon, just a reminder.
Completely canon, are you kidding me? Alright, I wrote an entire essay on why I think Pen is a test pilot for it was great fun. So, Pen is this random penguin living with Misato, who, to most people, is just simply comedic relief and has nothing to do with the actual series. I disagree, however. Misato says at one point that he's smarter than a penguin. He's genetically somehow made smarter, enhanced. And that's pretty peculiar. Why would some random company. She says it's from another company. She says it's not from Nerve. Now, not from Nerve, however, could mean Garen, which is the company that came before Nerve. Not completely sure about that. But the thing is that Pen was genetically modified somehow. And it's a little weird. He's also living with Misato. Misato's household consists of two pilots, and towards the later parts of the series, Asuka and Shinji. And so it would be fairly convenient if, Nerve decided, hey, you know, Misato, just take this penguin. Maybe they didn't even tell her about whether it was a test pilot or something. But I think he was the original test pilot for EVA Unit 00. And I think that, now this is the crazy part, is that the EVA Unit 00, which I believe can't have the soul of Ray 1, because Ray 1 is not the mother of Ray 2, I believe that the soul inside of EVA Unit 00 is Pen's mother. So that's why it rejected Ray. 3 days before the series begins, in a flashback, you see this, you see EVA Unit 00 go berserk when Rei tries to pilot, and it punches a glass. Well, who's standing behind that glass? Well, it's Gendo, and it's Ritsuko. So, now the thing is that Ritsuko, you imagine at that point that he's trying to punch Gendo, like the robot is mad at Gendo or something. But later Ritsuko says, no, it wasn't going for Gendo, it was going for me. I can't remember exactly the exact scene or episode or whatever, but it is confirmed that she says that the EVA unit was trying to get at her and not Gendo. Well, Ritsuko is the main scientist for Nerve, So I see it as a very likely possibility that maybe she was the one that did the experiments on Penpen and Penpen's mother. She genetically enhanced, or perhaps it was her, like, Ritsuko's mother. What's her name?
Naoko.
Naoko. So Penpen's mother is in this robot and is like, hey, that's the chick who put me into this thing and then tortured my little baby. And I think that's why the robot went berserk. Now, there's a lot more information I have on this. There's a lot of, I can't remember all of them. Penpen, even in the alternate universe that you see in episode 26, the alternate universe that you see consists of some random stuff going on. You know, their high school lives, they're living their regular high school lives. But Shinji still has a plush toy of Penpen on his desk, which is kind of weird. Like, Shinji would have never met Penpen at all. Like, why would this have happened? And so it's these little hints all over the place that are kind of intriguing. But there's way more. So I can't remember all of them. Do you remember any others that I had? Okay, let me think. 30 seconds.
Really cool.
So Penpen, this little penguin, is rescued from Antarctica. This is, again, all theory. There's actually two survivors of the expedition, Masato and Penpen. So Penpen, rescued from Antarctica, his home destroyed. You know, it's like, okay, you know what? Why don't we give Penpen to Masato, the other survivor? Makes sense, right? Now they can live together. And why don't we make him a test pilot? Because, you know, when humans send people to space, they don't just send humans. They sent a monkey first, right? They sent other animals first. Why would you risk putting a human into an EVA unit that you don't know what's going to happen yet? You don't know how to control it. You don't know how to pilot it. Why not just put something that can, you know, maybe perhaps move the EVA unit slightly, even just to test it? Makes a bit more sense. Now, Antarctica was just completely destroyed. So it also makes sense that perhaps they decide, what better way to fight the angels than with an animal that whose entire home was destroyed by this cataclysm, the second impact? So it's all these little things that I have no proof of course. I mean, I'm sure you can tell, but it's all these little things. And then Penpen is put and tested and stuff, and then, yeah, question. So it is on Reddit. It is on Reddit. You can find it there. I have a copy, but I can't really hand it out because that's not gonna be easy. So go on Reddit/r/Evangelion and search it up. It's Penpen theory or something. You'll find it. I'm sure you'll find it. Anyways, it's awesome. But I have way more data than that. So I think Penpen, more of a comedic relief, is something else. It's something that's just there as a quirk. Something that's there is like a little, you know, hidden mystery. Perhaps someone will find it one day. And, you know, it's a fun theory. That's why I think Penfit's my favorite character. But all right, I've wasted enough of your time. Does anyone have questions? Yeah.
So if souls return to the door of the gulf when they die, and humans can't open it, how are we getting the souls put in through the Evangelion?
Okay, so that's during a contact experiment. The contact experiment is done while the person is still alive. So, for example, Shinji's mother died during the contact experiment by fusing itself into the core of the Evangelion Unit 01. The same way as Asuka's mother fused into the core of what would later become Eva Unit 02. With Rei, it's more... So Gabe's got a point there. It's way more difficult with Rei to know which soul was put inside because Rei 1 died before she could have been put into the Evangelion unit. Except we also know that souls are still retrievable after death because Rei 2 died and it was immediately transferred into Rei 3. Even though she couldn't remember most of the things from her existence as Rei 2, she could still recognize, for example, Gendo's glasses and just say, hey, this guy treated me badly and, like, cry and break them.
So she still regains some memories. So so the soul is still transferable after death. So it could have still been reborn.
Now hold on, I think someone in the back had one. Well, hold on. No?
Yeah.
Okay, front first then.
Yeah, I was actually just wondering if you guys may have actually talked about this before, but the possibility that Unit Zero contains the soul of Naoko Akagi?
It's been considered, but
I think it's been confirmed that it's not possible.
It's not possible.
I can't remember exactly why.
It's just because of the Unit Zero semi-berserk moments. The people that she supposedly tries to kill would align with Nyako's.
Yes. Again, I don't know the exact facts on why it may or may not be possible. That'd be something to just do a quick Google search, and I'm sure you'll find whether it is or it's not. It's actually probably one of the main theories that's out there. I'm not 100%. The only one I did research on particularly was the Ray 1 to Ray 2 interaction, which is currently the most accepted theory, but again, I don't think Ray 1, like, it's gotta be a mother, it can't be, like, yourself.
Yeah.
It doesn't really make sense.
That's
right,
so...
yeah.
So, it's required to have a habitable soul.
It's not, that's the thing. The first time the entry plug enters and takes control of Radio 01, she lets it go because she's like, what's this? It was probably the sign to take over the soul that's inside the core. And the core let it through, and it happened. It was also maybe even part of their master plan to let Shinji almost kill Toji. But as we see in the episode thereafter, the entry plug, the dummy plug is unusable. The Evangelion won't turn on with the dummy plug, so the soul still has power over the dummy plug. It can still take over and say no, I'm not gonna turn on.
Mm-hmm. So it's likely that the first time the dummy plug is used is the only time it could possibly work, because like the soul inside the EVA unit was like, oh, what's okay? There's a new thing coming. Oh, okay, I guess I'll let it through. Once it let it through, it didn't really have an option of what it could do. It was already infected, in a way. Now, a very, very interesting thing we see in the rebuilds, this is the only time I'm going to mention the rebuilds, I think, is if you watch the scene where the dummy plug takes over the Evangelion unit backwards, if you watch that scene backwards, you hear something along the lines of, I will take over your mind, in English, something like that. I will take over your mind, and another line or two.
It's regarding them saying it's better for me to take over your mind than one of the other Illum. So it's basically whatever the voice is coming from is saying rather me than one of them.
Yeah. So that is a pretty cool thing that was found. I don't know how someone managed to find it. I mean, who watches a series backwards just for fun?
Well, I do, apparently.
And you have to listen carefully too. It's not easy. It's not easy to catch.
Yeah, it took me several tries, even listening it backwards, just to get what she was saying. She was saying.
Yeah.
It's just, even though it's obvious that there's words, it's just really difficult to grasp because it's a very robotic voice. And it's not like as clear as a Vocaloid, let's say. It's just really, really robotic.
Yeah, it's just a really robotic voice. But it does kind of lend to that thing where it's like the dummy plug only worked the once, because it managed to like convince the soul to let it in. And then after that, the soul was like, no, never mind, you're kind of evil. So after that, it didn't work. All right.
I just have a question about theories. I found most of the stuff just on the internet. You guys seem to know a lot more than stuff out there, but... is there any validity to the rebuilds are a sequel to the original Evangelion theory?
There's a lot of evidence that supports both, and denies it. One of the main arguments that they used to use was the blood on the moon that was left in the end of Evangelion. You could see it at the start of 1.0. But in every other scene in which the moon motif is on, specifically in Ray scenes, in which, you know, they paint the moon really big, just to make it obvious that it's her motif, you don't see it. So, like, the line is clearly visible from Earth. It's a pretty big, gigantic line of red blood. So why you wouldn't be able to see it even if even in an up-close picture is pretty obvious that it's there more for symbolic purposes of, hey, it's like we're rebuilding the series. It's kind of a continuation or an alternate reality, but it's not the same. Because if that's that would be the only clear evidence that I would find would clearly state that it's a continuation of the same universe.
There were a couple other theories though that I saw. There was one about how at the beginning of the original series the ocean's blue,
yes.
Whereas at the end of Evangelion it's red, and at the beginning of the rebuilds it's
yes.
also red.
In I think that's more to emphasize the impact, the second impact again.
Yeah.
So remember that the Antarctica sea was red in the original series, but the rest of the sea was still blue. That wouldn't be very consistent with the fact that every animal in the ocean died, so or the fact that a lot of catastrophic events, tsunamis happened. So it just, I think, would handle better if they just painted all the whole sea red.
There was just one more, just sorry
okay.
about this, but at the end of Evangelion, the empty Evas all scattered kind of across the ocean, the cross formation, at the beginning of the first rebuild movie, you see the outlines
yes.
laying in the actual
yes.
destruction.
Now that one I cannot explain. I was also pretty fascinated by it when I saw it, but seeing as that there's no consistent evidence, like the other two examples you brought up, it just seems kind of impossible that the mass production of Evangelions would be there. Especially since there was no bodies found, or the sailors. There were up to a third movie and we still hadn't found any of them. So.
So yeah, I'm a supporter of the theory that it is a continuation in some form, if not a direct sequel. So, things I'd like to bring up are Kaoru's, like, the way he actually refers to Shinji being
yes.
Past tense.
Now, I
time.
Refer to that as the loop theory,
yes,
which is, it doesn't say it's a continuation, but it says that there's a loop of alternate realities occurring, reoccurring. So, even in that situation, some of the speculation of the loop theory goes as far as to say that each movie, 1.0, 2.0, well, 1.1, 2.2, and 3.3 are all each different universes.
That would explain 3.
Because because from 1.1 to 2.2, we see slight changes here and there, and from 2.2 to 3.3, we see slight changes here and there. According to 2.2, the third impact would have stopped. Like, we saw at the end of 2.2, Shinji getting speared to death. Not speared to death. He gets speared, the impact stops. The impact type event stops, right? So why did a third impact occur? It shouldn't have. It either happened in the 15-year time loop by some other reason that Shinji doesn't remember, even though he got stuck in that plug forever. Or another time loop started in which the impact did happen. And base for the time loop theory that I do support, because it would explain more of the alternate realities, is that Kaoru is actually the only viewer who can actually, as you said, experience all of these realities, because he's a more transcendental entity that can get reborn and reborn.
I'd just say, like to say along with that, quantum ray.
Quantum ray is, has anyone here heard of quantum ray? Okay, so I'm going to explain quantum ray really fast, because it's really a great concept to explain. Quantum ray is god ray. When ray turns into a god in End of Evangelion, she has all of the powers that a god could have. And most of us just think of a god, oh, a god is all powerful, but like, do you ever stop to think, what can a god do? He can go into the past, he can go into the future, he can do whatever he wants, right? So why not go to the start of the series, just when Shinji is hanging up on the phone, and make a flock of birds fly and just appear in the middle of the street and then disappear, and Ray's all and Shinji gets all confused and he's like, "Oh, who's that person?" Right? And then at the end of the series, he just like wakes up, and that hallucination that he sees, just wakes up, sees Ray floating the same way he saw her in the first episode, and then disappears right immediately right after. The quantum ray theory states that as she became God, she also went to the past and the future in the same span of time, in her godliness, obviously, to just welcome him into his adventure and say goodbye.
Yeah, so bound to that, I'd just like to say that having quantum ray appear in the rebuild of Evangelion is already a contrary event, seeing as Lilith's body has been completely dismantled as of 3.33.
Yeah.
So I'm just saying that that quantum ray stretching over from the end of Evangelion's events, saying that she can stretch different universes,
yes,
be anywhere she wants.
So the alternate reality theory, or the time loop theory, is a more solid theory as to the rebuild the movies, because it doesn't necessarily say it's right immediately after end of Evangelion.
Maybe they're just fucking messing
they are.
With us.
They are. Clearly. Yeah. Any other questions?
No? Alright, I think we're out of time, so.
Well, we have 7 minutes.
7 minutes?
But, like, I don't know, any other?
Yeah.
Like, I read on the internet that, like, the creator of Emma has said that, like, his series is actually meaningless. And then also, I've read other articles where he says that, like, okay, he actually hates that when he's created, and he hates the fans of Emma, and you're a fan of Emma, he hates you immediately.
So, Steve made me read a
I made
short
him read a very short manga called Insufficient Direction. Written by Moyoko Anno, which is Hideaki Anno's wife. And this manga is all about her converting to an otaku wife. And if we take that as tier one canon, both her and him are otakus, like really, really hardcore otakus. They handed out doujinshi for their wedding. So if we take this as true, if we can believe it, there's also an essay at the end that Anna wrote for this book that says, my wife did a better job at describing the message I wanted to send in Evangelion in this manga. And the message that the manga sent was, it's not bad to be an otaku, but it's bad to spend all of your money on things that are not making you a better person. So he doesn't critique buying a figure or buying a book, because they buy figures, they buy books. But they're manga writers, they're directors, they're learning from others and adding to their own experience by that. And we've seen examples of very hardcore, especially Japanese otakus, not American otakus, thank God, of them just quitting school and using their university money to buy just more manga, more books. They're just hikikomoris, the social situation in Japan, things like that. It just lends more to use your parents' money into things that are not helping you get a better life going on, right? So the message in Evangelion is that it's not bad to buy things that make you happy. It's good, but it's always have a clear view on your life. It's continue on the right path. Don't just waste your life in things that are obviously not gonna do anything in the end.
Yeah, and to expand onto that, as you can see in episodes 25 and 26, which are like just the blank black screens, that's where the message is trying to be sent. That's where Hideaki Anno is like, okay, well, it's fine to, you know, sometimes be in your dreams. It's fine to sometimes be, you know, just out of reality with the world. But sometimes you have to get back to reality. Sometimes you have to accept who you are. You have to be yourself. And you have to be happy about who you are. You can't just escape into your dreams all the time. And that's what those last few sequences are kind of trying to portray, in that sense. That it's like, get a grasp on your own life, and don't just stay in your dreams forever. You know, get back into your reality as well.
Exactly. Any other questions?
Nope. All right, I think we'll cut it off there. If anyone wants to see Steve's 18 plus images. they're not that bad. They're not like hentai or anything. But yeah.
Some of them.
You guys had like a blog or anything like that?
Oh, okay. So we have a YouTube channel actually. We just changed names because I carried my previous name, Steve Ubach, and it's like I don't want to use my real name for this stuff. And we're actually aspiring panelists, more hardcore panelists. This is the first panel we wrote. This is actually the second edit of that panel to be longer, to span 2 hours. It's the only panel that we're planning on making this past 2 hours because it's really expensive and takes a lot of effort. But we are called the Anime Analysts on YouTube right now. We will upload actually this presentation in a few days. We actually have the first one from Tsukino-Con
already uploaded. It has like 500 views, you know, it's kind of small. Next year we're aiming to present Full Metal Alchemist Brotherhood, Theology and Science, 1 hour at Tsukino, and possibly here. We're planning on having a 1 year panel rotation kind of thing, where we create a new panel each year and present it at every anime con we've gone to before. As you see, we are currently in Victoria and Vancouver. We're planning on going to Seattle or Vancouver or Portland next year, and maybe even one day LA, if we get famous and all.
Yeah, so the main thing is, like, if we go to a new place that we're doing, so like Portland, etc.,
yeah.
We'll probably do the Evangelion panel because it's our most, you know,
not
laid out thing, right?
Yeah.
But we'll also be doing other stuff as well. But yeah, the anime analysts.
The anime analysts on
that?
YouTube. And,
so
yeah.
Right now we have the video from Tsukino-Con, which is the entire panel except for some cutouts, which unfortunately we're using Steve's camera, and it would just overheat every, like, 15 minutes after a while, and it was horrible. But we have most of the panel there, and the information's great. It's the exact same panel, except with different questions and stuff,
yes.
Right? So it's also interesting. But Steve is also the moderator for Reddit/r/Evangelion. So please, you know, check him out. Go to Reddit, Evangelion.
I'm
always
number
posting
seven,
stuff.
Number seven.
CL07 sound only. That's your thing.
CL07.
Touch AMV.
What?
The Evangelion Touch AMV. That's the DAP sound one.
Oh,
handsome.
I saw it, but I can't check every post.
Yeah.
I haven't been able recently, especially because I was working on this.
Oh yeah.
We actually almost always procrastinate towards the end.
We were
so,
doing finishing
so
touches
we all
last
know,
night. So.
We know our stuff, like from the back
yeah.
of our head, we know everything, we just like always leave it to the end.
Yeah.
So actually we kind of procrastinated to the FMA panel, and we want to start getting it ready for February.
But yeah, so if you guys want any more information on Evangelion, feel free to message him on Reddit, and we have, or on YouTube even. You can send messages on YouTube, right?
Yeah,
I don't use YouTube.
Well,
because
it's connected to Google Plus.
Yeah.
So send messages.
So the anime analysts or Reddit. Reddit is the easiest way to reach me because I'll check it daily. But anime analysts is definitely a pretty easy way to reach us. We also have an email, theavapanel@gmail.com, I think.
That's evangelionpanel@gmail.com.
Evangelionpanel@gmail.com.
Pretty easy to remember.
So through there you can reach us, although it'll probably take like a bit because we don't check it very often.
I have it on my thing.
Oh, you have
it? I get it
okay.
automatically.
He gets it automatically then.
All right.
But through there. And we
okay.
gotta clean up, but thank you for coming. It was a good time.